Everybody ready?
Yep.
Let's go.
Lothrak, Lothcat, Lothwolf, run. Pick a path, and all is done.
War Midwest Guys presents Star Wars Rebels HQ.
Continue to allow this war to be fought on the Empire's terms. You are going to lose.
All paths are coming together now.
As long as we're together, we've got a chance.
At least we'll go down fighting. It's time to get to work.
Your TIE Defender is at risk. Krennic has been quite persuasive about his own project.
Ezra, it's not whether or not we fight.
It's how we choose to fight that matters. I know, Kanan.
We were meant to be Jedi so we could be here now when Lothal needs us most.
All the paths are coming together, right?
I'm just not sure if we're going to like where they lead.
But we never imagined it would end.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Star Wars Rebels HQ. Today we'll be reviewing Season 4, Episodes 3 and 4, In the Name of the Rebellion, Parts 1 and 2. Here to help me do that today is Mr. Brian Ankenbauer.
Hey, what's up?
What's going on, B?
Not much, man.
And my half-dead, half-asleep brother, Aaron.
Hey, man, how's it going?
Good. You gonna make it?
I don't know.
Not sure? All right. We'll see what happens. It's late. It's real late. It's only 2 in the morning, so we'll see if he can make it through.
It's early.
It is early. So, but before we get started, just in case you haven't watched episodes 3 and 4, parts 1 and 2, I have to warn you.
Spoiler alert. Spoiler alert.
Confidence is high. I repeat, confidence is high.
Flush the bombers, get the subs in launch mode. We are at...
Spoiler alert.
So yes, this is a spoiler alert, because if you haven't watched these episodes, you probably shouldn't listen to this podcast.
I also just want to point out there, we paid somebody different this time to do our notes, so the show may sound a little bit different than normal.
That's all right. I think it'll be just fine. I'll admit I didn't have time to do the notes this week, so it is what it is. But Mr. Ekbar was ever so kind as to fill in for me.
I tried.
So, all right, let's get started. So right off the bat, it looks like Sabine and Ezra and Kanan are all coming back from Mandalore,
mm-hmm.
and Chopper as well. And they start talking about they're heading for Yavin 4. So pretty short trip to Mandalore, like we were talking about last podcast. And already moving back to the main Rebel group. But what they've now, Phoenix Squadron has now joined the greater Rebel cell at Rebel Home Base, or Home Base 1, if I remember correctly, is how they refer to it. At Yavin 4, for those of you not sure what we're talking about, we're actually talking about the Yavin 4 planet that you see in A New Hope. It's the same one with the like Aztec-like temples, I guess you would call it.
Yeah, that's what I call them.
Yeah. So
also saw in Rogue One.
In Rogue One, same thing. So again, that's another connection to Rogue One, another connection to the original trilogy we're seeing here. So right off the bat, we see that they start talking about this new Rebel cell and how Phoenix Squadron has indeed been, what's left of it anyway, has been absorbed into it, and that they're more equipped and better equipped than Phoenix Squadron ever was, apparently.
Yep.
So they're a little nervous about joining a new group, but they're going to be much better off, I guess, is what they're kind of coming to, talking themselves into, maybe. I don't know. What do you think, Brian?
Right. It just seems like they're coming into the... What we recognize from watching Star Wars, A New Hope, of the Rebels, we're actually seeing kind of that formation, which is kind of cool. They're talking about, you know, they're coming from Mandalore, and the rest of the Phoenix Squadron came from the battle where they got ambushed by Thrawn.
Right.
And they got their ships and people got absorbed into this new cell.
Right.
Which is becoming like this mega cell, if you will.
Yeah. Aaron, what'd you think about them talking about becoming part of the, I guess, the greater rebellion now, even?
So I mean, it tied into last season very well, just you mm-hmm. kind of see how it transitioned, but I'm not really sure if it does much for the storyline currently. I mean, it definitely does tie into a lot of things, though.
Yeah. I definitely get the Star Wars feels. I mean, they do a good job for the old Star Wars fans like me and even the newer fans that saw Rogue One, and it's a nice little tie-in.
So. You know what I noticed? Usually talk about the music, but one thing I noticed when they were pulling up on, you know, on Yavin 4,
yeah,
it was like you could almost hear the Star Wars theme as it was pulling in, but it wasn't quite...
ever so subtle.
Right, but it wasn't quite like... it was missing a few notes.
Yeah, like they intentionally left it out. Mm-hmm. Well, even in Rogue One, when they approach Yavin 4, you get that da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It's the Rebel fanfare, you know, kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So, I didn't pick up on that, but that's kind of cool. I'll have to go next time I watch it, because I will watch it again, being the nerd, Star Wars nerd I am. So, all right, so when they get there, Zeb kind of comes to meet him, and he's kind of showing him around, kind of sort of. Maybe it's me, but will they ever get Zeb to walk right? He never looked more awkward, and the animation has gotten a lot better, but Zeb's walking still needs a little bit of work.
Well, yeah, I mean, that was one thing I noticed. When the first time I saw it, and I asked you the next day, and I was like, dude, did you see the animation when these guys running on this base? It wasn't just Zeb. I mean, Zeb looked awkward.
Right, but he's supposed to be a little awkward because of the way he's built.
But his animation looked a little awkward. But even when Rex and Kanan and Ezra and everybody... we're running. The next scene we're going to talk about.
Yeah,
the animation seemed a little sketchy. Not as bad as what we saw that one time on the mining world.
Yeah, the squale episode. Yeah, yes.
not as bad as that one, but you know,
was there a flaw in that episode? Because I don't remember it
in the squale episode.
Yeah,
yeah. When the big guy was running.
Yeah, he looked like Mario Brothers.
Brothers. Yeah, I remember that now. I thought that was intentional.
We could never go to Star Wars one of these Rebels podcasts while I talk about squales.
I know.
I mean, I need
to make T-shirts.
There's later on where you start hearing like him, like listening to like the song of like the one crystal, and it's like, it's a squale.
I know. I was like, let it be a squale. Let it be a squale.
I was hoping, man, and it just didn't come through.
Yeah, we even saw the big box, and you're like, it's a huge box. It's going to be a squale. And I'm like, oh, no.
Yeah, I was expecting like a little baby squale.
It was a Kyra crystal. Come on.
Yeah.
Anyway, we'll get to that, though. So it's you know, he's just kind of showing him around, I guess. And it really does show that the galaxy has kind of come together. Maybe not quite to what we're used to in the Rebel Alliance in the movies, but it's getting closer.
Right. Ezra does bring up, he's like, look at all these ships and all these people. Mm-hmm. And then Zeb does say, you know, a lot of the rebellion squadrons from around the galaxy have come here together, and he's like, but it's still not enough.
Mm. True. It still shows how much, you know, it's literally David versus Goliath, if you will, you know, literally.
Mm-hmm.
Then Ezra brings up Lothal, and he's like, what about Lothal? Aren't we going to Lothal? Aren't we going to help? Because they start talking about their new mission a little bit, and it's all about...
She crashes down onto the planet, sort of thing, or
I think you're right.
That hasn't happened yet.
That hasn't happened yet. Oh, he starts talking almost off the bat. He's like, "Well, we're gonna help with all, right?
Look at all these people that can help with all."
He's talking about that before we go into the bit with him and Mon Mothma.
He's starting to bring it up already before they even have.
They're planting that seed in everybody's head that Ezra's still worried about his home planet, kind of thing.
Yeah. And I think, Brian, you have a point here. You think this might turn him away maybe from the rebellion down the road?
Like we were talking on our spoiler thing, like what we thought might happen.
Right.
And,
like he might go out on his own.
Like he might go out on his own. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, just the subtle backstory behind all this stuff that you just hear little snippets. And Ezra is, you know, what about Lothal? I'm worried about Lothal. And then it's, you know, worry about the greater good. Worry about the greater good. Okay, I understand, but I'm still mad about Lothal. You know. Right. You hear it, and it's just one of those things that I think personally that it's going to turn into the thing where he's like, the rebellion's good, I'm going back to Lothal to help.
Right. That could very well be.
The same way you see Sabine kind of leaving the Mandalorian Civil War to kind of help the greater rebellion.
Mm-hmm. For the greater good kind of a deal. And it could definitely be a linchpin because coming up here in a few minutes, there's definitely a little bit of a conflict. Then obviously it switches. Actually, before this, real quick, we do get to see the return of what's his name, Agent Kallus. Now, in
no, not yet,
not yet. Oh, mm-mm. Well, see, I've only watched it twice this time. So.
Oh, what's going on here?
I know.
This is the part where Rex comes up.
That's right.
And they're like, "Oh, Rex, you're here!" And then all of a sudden, alarms go off.
That's right. So they
Rex bit was very small.
Yep.
Like, honestly, I don't
It was almost just like they wanted you to know Rex was there, and that's enough.
Yeah.
Kind of, because you don't see him the rest of the
episode. That's why the first part of these notes is also because we see Zeb, we see all the people, then we see Rex, then we see Hera, then we see Wedge, and then we see Callus, and it was like, oh my god, they got so much stuff in the very beginning of this.
Just trying to reintroduce us and let us know that they survived, and yet they're still here.
Mm-hmm.
So the alarms go off, and it sounds like Hera's mission, that's wherever she was off with some Phoenix, maybe with Phoenix Squadron, but she was in Y-Wings this time.
Mm. Yeah, it was a supply mission.
Yeah, that's right, a supply mission, so... again, I only watched this twice, guys. I apologize. It was a rough week. I will do better next week, I promise. At least five times, I promise. But it looks like she's run into some real problems here because she's on fire, Wedge is on fire, and the other guy, there's three of them left, and they're all coming in hot and heavy, and we get a nice reintroduction to Hera's piloting skills and leadership skills here, I think, just watching her crash land the Y-Wings, literally bringing it in hot. The physics didn't add up.
No, did not.
Honestly, I was almost expecting them, like, you have Kanan and Ezra there doing, like, a force push sort of thing.
Yeah. 100% and, that's what I thought they were going to do.
They never did it. It's just like, nope, just landed fine.
Yeah, we're just going to let her run right through a pair of air stairs.
Hmm.
But even Kanan, to the point, though, to counterpoint, Kanan did say, she's got this.
Yep, she's got this.
So I guess it's showing he has faith. But yeah, I was kind of expecting at least a little bit of a force push.
Yeah.
Something, or at least try to grab the
ship. Just how quickly he was coming in and like how he was heading directly towards them.
Yeah.
Like, that's kind of what you expect. But no, you have her land safely, and then you just have like a bunch of people like coming to pull her out just in case the thing blows up.
Well, the other thing that was funny, I thought, was she's still moving forward, and they're still running towards her. I think you'd want the ship to stop first and then run towards her. But, hey, they're brave rebels. What can I say?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So we get to see Wedge again, kind of like we saw. And we see Hera show her awesome pilot skills and a little bit of leadership there. And just a reintroduction, I think, to that whole thing. Now we get to see the return of Callus, who is... apparently on the internet becoming quite popular these days, as there is now a hashtag called Hot Callus. Apparently,
because it was man chops.
The girls really dig Hot Callus, apparently, and now they really dig him in the rebel gear with his longer hair and rebel gear on.
Interesting.
I wonder.
How are you aware of this?
I have heard about it. It was all over Twitter. I literally stumbled upon it. It's not like I hashtag Hot Callus.
I go on
Twitter a lot with looking for Star Wars Rebels news and links and stuff, and
everybody's
putting Hot Callus, and it's a drawing of him in his Rebels gear, apparently.
Okay.
And there's also another one apparently of him in his back when he was in the Empire, and he had a couple pieces of hair down on his forehead, and all the girls were going crazy about it.
So weird.
I know, right? I don't get it.
Neither do I.
Even Filoni didn't get it. Filoni's like, here's a drawing. I don't get it. That's literally what he put. I don't get it. But, hey. All right. So I wonder what kind of a rank Callus has here, though, because they don't really say commander. They don't say... They don't even say his name. He just kind of shows up and...
We know who he is.
Right.
And he just says, Mon Mothra, I need you for a meeting.
Yeah.
He's a gopher.
Yeah. He doesn't say, that's not like, yes, sir, or whatever. None of that.
He is intern Callus.
You'd think he'd be, like, part of the intelligence group, you would think, or counterintelligence, because he knows all the Empire. Mm. I mean, he does offer something in the meeting coming up, but still, I don't know. I just wonder how high up in the Rebel ranks he is. I have to do some research on that one, I guess. So, I don't know. What do you think, Brian, real quick? Where do you think Callus' role is in the Rebellion now?
I think, like you said, I think he's an intelligence guy. I think he's part of the... We'll call it the inner circle.
Mm-hmm.
Because like we find out in the next thing when they're talking about the plan and stuff that he kind of starts, that he initiates. You can tell he has a voice.
Yeah,
and he's taken seriously. It's not like a whatever. Yeah. And so you can tell he may not have like an actual like title, but they do kind of respect his knowledge.
Opinion. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Aaron, any thoughts?
Oh no, I think he's an intern. I think he gets coffee, he goes grabs people.
Intern, like, go for...
Yeah, like, he's new, he has to, like, prove himself, and, like, just sometimes that means doing menial tasks.
You just gotta take it easy.
Yeah.
Sit back. Copy that.
Just has to do one thing at a time. He'll get there.
All right, then. Copy on that. So, so let's get into the plan. So they've got this new plan now. They want to use the ghost to wiretap a new communications tower because they've deciphered that this new communications tower now gets their plans out too quickly to the Empire, and the Empire is now able to react much quicker to you know,
the rebellion,
the rebellion in the whole. So this is where Kallus kind of offers up his two cents, I guess, about how they should maybe just tap into it and they can monitor it and then kind of work around the Empire so they can monitor almost as like a counterintelligence move.
Right.
Okay, well, we know you're listening, and now we can hear you and what your moves are, so we can now work around that.
And they also bring up that this is also the start of where we hear about Saul Guerrera and how did he get his intelligence? Because he told us that this was going to happen,
but our
intelligence didn't tell us that, so we went ahead and did it. And then Hera's like, and we got attacked. So how did he know? And they're like, well, Saul doesn't care how he gets his knowledge.
Right, that he doesn't play by our rules.
Right, and Ezra said, well, he gets results. And then that's when Mon Mothma looks at him kind of angry-like, and he's like, well, we don't abuse our prisoners.
Right, exactly.
Well, essentially, it kind of suggests he does the same sort of tactics you actually see in Rogue One.
And now it makes sense why we see that in Rogue One.
Because there's been this falling out.
Yes, and that's why that's how he gets his information. He doesn't care how he gets it, who he hurts. He's following those cookie crumbs.
Yeah, exactly. And it doesn't matter what price he has to pay or what he has to do. To him, it doesn't matter. It's all or nothing, literally.
Now we start talking about the plan.
Yes.
That was just the new information that they've gotten. And now we start talking about the plan.
The plan itself.
Which is the... Kallus brings it up and says, well, we could put a wiretap on.
Right.
And then Hera says, we can do it with the ghost. We've done it before.
Right. And I think even General Dodon even questions her.
Are you sure?
Sure. If we don't call it the ghost for nothing.
Yeah.
Duh.
Now we start getting back into Ezra's
whole
Lothal thing. And Ezra says, that's all fine and good, but how does that help Lothal?
How's that going to help Lothal? And literally, he gets a real stern look from Hera the minute he starts, because he says this to Mon Mothma, and he's taking it right to that. She's the head of the whole Rebel Alliance, politically anyway. And you can see Hera like giving him like a stern look, like, don't speak out of turn. What, are you crazy? You know.
Yeah, she even says this isn't the place for that.
Right, exactly.
Or no, this isn't the time
for that. Even reprimands him, tries to pull him back.
And he's like, well, we told Ryder we would come back with
he's
reinforcements.
Expecting us, yeah. He's expecting our help.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what are we going to do? And that's, and then, but Mon Mothma, to her credit, actually says, well, you know, I want to talk to you alone. Pulls him off to the side and tries to explain the situation, or at least her point of view to it, which I don't exactly agree with completely, but I get it. You know, that they're not ready for open warfare against the Empire.
Right, but she didn't even portray it that way. She just said, because she's like, that's fine, we want to help your planet, but my planet's under siege too.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, what if we help those two planets? But what about Alderaan and this planet and this planet? What do we do about all of these? Where do we begin? And it was like...
Pick one.
So... You have your alliances here on this planet.
Yep.
He has Lothal. So just pick one and go.
It's like I said. This is for me. It's hard to watch this because I've said it past, and I'll say it again. It really waters down my childhood image of the Alliance and always being the ones to rush in and kick the Empire's ass, or at least try to.
Right.
Like them using tact and trying to work in the situation and like build their forces. Like.
Yeah.
It really just is a disillusioning thing for you.
For me, it is, yeah, because as a childhood, you're like, I'm a rebel. I'm gonna, you know, I'm here to kick the Empire's butt, you know, to see the political reality of it, you're kind of like, God, this is like watching C-SPAN or something.
She goes about it. I mean, she does, and she pulls up that graphic like it's just like attached like to her arm or something, and she's like. And look at this one. And then she goes, and then she pulls it, and it's like, and what about all these planets? And you see certain planets that got the Empire logo on them,
right?
Because
they're under siege.
Under siege,
right?
And then I think just to shut her up, Ezra goes, "I understand, Senator. blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And, but it's like, does he really?
He doesn't.
No, I feel like he does on some level. It's just on the emotional level, it's still like, but Lothal is my home planet.
Exactly.
But you still have that logical level. It's like, I see where you're coming from, and that does make sense.
Right.
But the emotional aspect of it just doesn't really register the same way.
He's giving that almost like sigh. It's almost like, okay, yeah, I see where you're coming from. But inside, yeah, he wants to fight.
Yeah. Like, I understand why we need to stick to a budget, but that thing looks really nice and shiny.
I could definitely foresee this being something that they, you know, that somebody exploits against him, you know, and uses. Mm.
And that's what I. This whole thing that we keep hearing. I mean, there's this nice story going on, but that backstory that we're seeing is Ezra and Lothal and his pull back to that planet, and he wants to help his planet, and that's the whole reason why he. I mean, he even says the whole reason why I joined this rebellion was to help Lothal, and now I feel I'm even farther away than I was before.
Right, which leads to our next scene with Kanan, and we kind of see Kanan doing his Jedi meditation. And Ezra kind of walks up, and even Kanan kind of breaks meditation. Well, it doesn't even break meditation, just kind of voices out, acknowledges his existence, and goes, what's wrong?
you know, I can sense you're angry.
I can sense you're angry, you know. And then obviously, that's where we get the... And once again, you know, here's another line from the trailer. That's a lot of the trailer in the first couple episodes. Big surprise. It's not whether or not we fight, it's how we choose to fight that matters, you know. And I know Kanan, you know.
Yeah.
That whole line.
Kanan starts the sentence and then Ezra finishes it. So, like, it was...
Yeah.
You can tell. It's ingrained in him. He understands.
Right.
But then he says, you know, but Saul's getting results.
Mm. And we're not.
And we're not.
Mm-hmm.
And then he says, you know, maybe we're choosing the wrong way.
Exactly. And the whole time, this little droid is following him in the background. And I think Saul's listening into his conversation is what I think.
Because
I think that's why he shows up.
I didn't get that he was being followed. I did see the droid come out of the the cave or whatever.
Yeah.
But I don't think it was specifically following Ezra, because even when he turns around, it's way back in the back, shooting up into the sky.
Okay.
So I just think we just saw the droid coming out of the thing. I don't think he was being followed.
Okay. All right. Well, I actually think he's listening in. I think
could be.
Saul's doing his little snooping and intelligence gathering any way possible.
So do you think the droid was just wandering around picking up intelligence from other things?
I think he has an interest in Ezra because he's a Jedi and he thinks he's easily impressionable. And in this case, I think we're going to see a lot of Saul, especially after watching this episode. I think this season will be fairly heavy in Saul. He'll almost be like the antagonist. To Ezra, maybe, you know,
to turn to his advantage. I don't know. Not after what we see happen in the second episode.
I could see maybe see him pop up for like maybe half of one episode here or there.
Yeah, I think
I wouldn't expect him to be like a main thing.
Well,
we almost see him like the who's the pirate?
Two Tubes.
No. Who's the pirate that we saw in the first couple seasons?
Oh, you're talking about
Ezra's Hondo.
Yeah.
So. I think he'll pop in and out like that. So we may get an episode where they run into him again, or he's getting intelligence again. We see that, but I don't see him being
really.
Yeah, heavy. I actually thought this was going to be the episode he got injured. Like, especially there towards the end when he's actually like shooting at the Kyber crystal.
Well,
like, stabs into it. It's like, I thought it was going to blow up, and like that's what happened to him.
And that's something yet to happen. So that's why I think we're definitely going to see him in another major story arc, because I think it would be a disjustice if they don't show how he's injured. By the time we get to Rogue One,
well, he's obviously going to Jedha,
right?
I mean, he was in Jedha in Rogue One,
right? That's his base of operations. This
is the first time we talked about Jedha.
This is the first time we hear about Jedha
in Rebels. Yeah.
Yeah, so
that comes in later.
That's later on, but we're jumping ahead. But hey, that's what we do. So, and of course, Ezra ends this whole scene, you know, with, well, maybe we are choosing the wrong way.
And then as he finishes that, that's when Saul. The hologram pops up that is like super huge.
Yeah, I mean, he's like
he's got at least be up.
Like, he's giant, like, floating head in the sky.
He's like Snoke big.
Yeah, exactly. Like 50 feet hitting high in the air.
Yeah, exactly. And then it's basically Saul kind of going on and on about, you know, he's basically tearing Mon Mothma a new one the whole time, calling her a coward, you know, for joining him, you know, not joining him, and. Just puts down that, you know, they're not getting any results. You know, and this is the reason for Mon Mothma, you know, you know, the whole Rogue One mission, which we see in Rogue One, her mission denial, et cetera, et cetera.
Is that what, I mean, I put that in there in the notes. Do you think that's what, that's the reason why she's hesitant?
Because...
Like there's all this, doubt in people's minds about her leadership abilities, so that's why she's not forceful. Like, even when they had that big circle.
Yeah.
And she, instead of saying, yes, let's do that, she's like... she goes along with everybody else. I agree that we can't do blah, blah, blah.
I think she is a very much a... She's a skillful tactician and knows... She chooses her battles very carefully and is very careful about how she goes about getting her results politically. She
even says she'd much rather get a political and... A
solution.
Political solution than a war.
War, right. So she's a pacifist, really, that has... basically accepted the fact that they have to fight, mm-hmm. you know, due to no other recourse. But, yeah, I think she really chooses her fights carefully and chooses her words carefully and how she presents herself. So, yeah, which may get better results in the long run, but in these scenes we've seen her in so far, including Rogue One, it makes her look very, weak, really, mm-hmm. honestly.
I agree.
So, I don't know. Aaron, what do you think about Mon Mothma?
I think she's trying to be as tactful as possible, and I think there is a certain naivety in expecting to have a peaceful resolution at this point in stage, looking at how the Empire has acted so far. At the same time, I can understand the desire to, you know, try to move forward as peacefully as possible, maybe try to have some sort of, you know, negotiation where you kind of maybe divide settlements or land or whatever, but... Everything we've seen up to this point suggests that's very unlikely scenario.
Right, that there's not going to be.
I think the best you can do in terms of a political thing is actually just kind of delaying the Empire striking until you build up your forces to a better extent.
Which is what they're trying to do at this point.
I'm not really sure how successful it is in delaying the actual Empire itself, though.
Yeah, I think because she doesn't understand what the Empire is really trying to do, like with the Stardust program, aka the Death Star, just how little time she really has.
Yeah.
Well, it's that old adage of, you know, if you continue to wait, you're never going to have enough. You might as well just do it.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Like if you continue saving
forever,
you're going to think you don't have enough.
Mm-hmm. The situation will never be perfect.
And then you've wasted all that time that you could have been doing stuff, mm-hmm. trying to wait to have enough saved, and by that time, all that time has been wasted.
Yeah, exactly. Moving on though, let's move on to the actual mission. So we see him the ghost approach this planet, and this transmitter is on. It's basically just actually it looks exactly like the transmission tower that we see in Rogue One.
Yeah, it's just a giant satellite.
It's the same one from Endor too, isn't it?
Very similar? And it's Endor's like a giant looking satellite dish. So yeah, maybe.
Essentially what this is.
I think the satellite dish is much bigger on Endor because it's a shield and this is just a transmitter. But it's like they took a snapshot right out of Rogue One and animated it. I mean, it's basically what it is.
Yep.
It's this tower on top of a mountain, really, way up high on this planet. They kind of swoop in and, Ezra's just kind of, I guess, is frustrated by the fact that nothing hurts the Empire, I guess, here. Is that what you meant by this part?
Because he's discussing that they're having that conversation and they're going over what they need to do and we're going to do this and that. And he goes, that's fine, but, you know, it doesn't really hurt the Empire. And Sabine's like, no, it doesn't, but it's going to help us work around. But you do have a point.
Yeah, that we're not really doing anything.
Yeah, and then Hera's like, you guys aren't seeing the bigger picture. And Ezra goes, yeah, but... And then Hera cuts him off really, really quick and with a stern voice and says, it's not up for discussion.
Mm-hmm.
And then walks away, right. and so I put the notes in here. I said, "Who is Hera trying to convince? Ezra and Sabine herself,
more herself than those two, because even she's not, she's enforcing Mon Mothma's doctrine, but even she is frustrated by her doctrine.
Right. So and she does say in the next scene when they're in the cockpit and Kanan comes in, he goes, I don't have to see your face in order to know you're frustrated and what's going on.
Yeah.
And she's like,
They're right.
I want to hurt them the way they've been hurting us, especially what they just did to
her,
our mission.
Right.
I just want to hurt them. And he goes, no, that's Saul talking. Yeah. We're doing the right thing.
Right, exactly. Yeah. He's kind of reassuring her that this is the right path, that this is more the Jedi path, per se. Even,
right.
of things of doing. Ezra, Chopper, and Sabine, they all get out of the Ghost, and then they put a spike in place. Now, this is one thing I picked up on. There's no spike. She says, I'm putting the spike in place.
The spike was more of a program.
Yeah.
Like it was just a bunch of buttons she hit.
She hit, yeah. In the past, when they've seen, they said spike, it's like a little antenna-looking thing that they throw in there. So even I picked up, it's like, okay, either somebody in the animation department screwed up here, or it's, you know, just another term that they're using, but... I think somebody screwed up. But anyway, so they do this whole free fall thing, which is kind of cool. It's like they're like, yeah, if we slow down with the thrusters too soon, we're going to get picked up, so we have to wait till the last possible second. So
right. So does this remind anybody else of Tomb Raider?
Yeah, Tomb Raider.
So Tomb Raider did that when they had the suits where they fly in.
It really.
There's also like another war movie where
like Mission Impossible maybe had this.
I think Mission Impossible had, they call them halo jumps where they high altitude,
right.
Long range.
Even the Kingsman,
yeah,
had this in it.
Yeah, it was cool to see animated though. Mm-hmm. I thought they did a really good job with it, and remind me of the Navy SEALs because they do the halo jumps and stuff too.
But what I found really funny was that. They're coming through, and then Ezra grabs the pole, which would have ripped his arm off.
Yeah.
And then he grabs Sabine, which ripped her arm off.
Why doesn't he use the Force?
Yes.
To hold her back.
Yes. And then...
Or Chopper.
Yes. That's my next point.
Yeah.
Because then they're both standing there, and then Chopper's coming down with sparks and everything coming, and Ezra doesn't use the Force to stop him. They just step out of the way and let him go smack into the thing. I'm like... Nobody heard that down there?
I mean, even if he couldn't have done it, it would have been nice to see him at least try to reach out with the Force and try to stop him.
Right.
I agree with you 100%. I was thinking the same thing. I'm like, okay.
But I mean, I did think it was funny, though, that when they both hit the satellite dish, the computer monitor on the inside kind of had a little static.
Yeah.
And all the Empire guy did, all he did was just, he tapped the monitor and it went away. And he's like, oh, okay.
Okay. Whatever.
Yeah.
Okay, so they make it down, and so they put the spike into the communications transmission, kind of like we're talking about, and then, of course, out of nowhere comes one of the Star Destroyer, not even a Star Destroyer, I forget what they call them, they're like the smaller Star Destroyers,
Commander ship,
I forget.
I thought they called it a Destroyer when they said it.
It's a smaller... small. It's Star Destroyer is the big one that we see in space, but this is like the smaller...
basically same shape
anyway
smaller.
Yeah, same shape and smaller, so all of a sudden they're like
mini destroyer.
They're like, okay, shit, okay, time to hide, and they go on the other side of the transmission, and then the TIE fighters show up first. That's right.
Well, no, what happens is They tap into the main communication line, so they hear Ezra say, "We want to dock, requesting permission to dock. Your transmission's really garbled." And here they cut off the transmissions to the control room, and they have it inside Chopper. And then Ezra says, "No, I got this," and he does his Imperial voice, which is pretty good,
right?
And then he's like, "Who is this?" And he's like, "This is
Commander such and such."
It's the guy who just met the other one.
Yeah, the one.
Tarkin. No, not Tarkin.
Not Tarkin. This is
start with a T.
This is a guy that
TARDIS.
TARDIS or something like that. This is the guy that has been going down in rank. He started out as an admiral.
Yeah,
and he's been going every time he runs into the rebels, he ends up with a lower rank.
Yeah, and he's like, I'm blah 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 blah. Who is this? And he's like, oh great, like that's just our luck.
Who is this? What's your operating number?
Yeah,
it was a pretty funny scene, and I was like, Ezra, you dumbass.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I'm thinking the whole time.
Yeah, and then all of a sudden they start tilting the dish, and then they start sliding,
yep.
And they make it all the way to the end, and he's just sitting there, and Ezra waves, and it's like,
It's that boy!
Damn it! That same kid!
Yeah, it was pretty funny.
Yeah, it's kind of a Home Alone kind of humor almost.
Mm-hmm.
So as they come back in to save him, that's when the TIE fighters show up to stop.
Right, when the ghost
stop
comes.
The ghost. Yep. To come in, and look who comes along though to save them is Saul. Well, maybe not even so much to save him, but to blow up the communications tower is Saul Guerrera in a U-wing. So we actually see a U-wing like we saw in Rogue One. Mm-hmm. Now in Rebels, this is the first time we see that. And also with Saul is Two Tubes.
So. Right, which is the same guy from Rogue One. So we're actually getting his little bit of his backstory. Not really backstory,
but he shows up.
We actually see him.
Makes an appearance, so we can see, you know, again, more Rogue One connections being thrown at us. So more connection there, which is always good to see. I really like that character, honestly. I'd like to know a little bit more about him.
He's only able to do that because the TIE Destroyers went after, or the TIE Defenders went after...
Oh, that's right. They released TIE Defenders. That's right.
They went after the Ghost, and Zeb's like, these aren't the regular TIE Fighters. These are the nasty ones.
Yeah.
And so then they're following them through the fog and stuff.
With Ezra guiding Hera.
Well, Kanan.
Or Kanan.
Yeah, and Kanan says, you want to lose them? And she's like, well, yeah. And he's like, do you trust me? And she's like, I guess.
Yeah.
And then they're guiding with his vision
of the Force.
Force vision of the mountains and stuff, flying through the fog that you can't see.
Yeah.
Which is kind of cool.
Which is neat. Yeah, it's kind of cool to see those two interact, and it shows their trust of one another, et cetera, et cetera, you know.
Right. And then as they're coming back, that's when we've seen that Saul has already deployed his big bombs.
Yep.
And blown up the communications tower. Yep. And at first, Hera and them, they think that the kids have blown up.
Yeah.
Because they keep referring to the kids. Let's go save the kids.
The kids, yeah, because they're mom and dad and everybody else is the kids, yeah.
And they think that they've blown them up. And then all of a sudden, they call out to him and like, oh, Saul's got us.
Yeah.
And it's like, she's like, oh, Saul.
Yeah, and she's like, we're docking right away. I'm going to get and pick my people
back. Yeah, we're pulling up next to you. I want my people back.
And that's when a Star Destroyer comes out of space. And
mm-hmm.
They have, you know, they decide that they're going to go with Saul. Actually,
yeah, well, because they don't have a choice. They can't stay there and try to change. They just jump, which I can see that being the case because, you know, you're just trying to get away from them.
Mm-hmm.
But my other thing would be, you know, tell them where you're going. Like, Saul had this plan.
Of course he did.
But it's one of those, like, if you really want, if you're just there to save or whatever, tell them where you're going so they can hyperjump right behind you.
Well, not only that, but I mean, Saul does kind of throw the choice to Hera and Sabine and Ezra.
Do you want to get out?
And they're having that conversation. They're like,
well, he said we don't really have a choice.
We don't have a choice, but you know, so he's already trying to pull them over to his side,
right? And then he says maybe they'll like to fight with a real rebellion.
See what it's like to fight with a real rebellion, yeah. So that pretty much brings us to... End of episode one. So we're halfway through. I'm really digging the two episode arcs so far.
It's funny. I don't even think they need to do two episodes. They could have just made them one big episode.
Yeah. I agree, but I'm sure that's probably something to do with Disney XD and how they do their programming and stuff. But still, it was pretty... It's really cool to see. And Aaron is officially out. That's okay. We'll go on without him. Sleep well, my friend. Sleep well. All right. So on to episode four.
Episode four. Just picks right back up where we left off. We're back on the ship again.
Right back on Saul's ship. And, you know, he shows him his plan. Like, he's like, I've been tracking. You remember what happened on the bug?
Genosis.
Mm-hmm. And I've never stopped looking. And
everybody else stopped, but I never did.
So here's what I found out, and he shows them the plans to this what looks like just a simple. Even Sabine says it looks like
a civilian transport
mm-hmm. station, mm-hmm. And he says no, he thinks there's something
right. And
something
you can tell there. That the conspiracy theory's got a hold on him, which is funny because we know from watching Rogue One and Star Wars and everything else, we know that he's on the right path,
right.
Thinking wise. But as you're watching it, if you had no idea what was going on, you'd be like, oh my God, this guy's conspiracy theory. What the heck is his problem?
Well, yeah, but even in Rogue One, we see he's extremely paranoid by that point. He doesn't trust anybody anything, you know.
So. And he's still trying to find that, those what the weapon is, what the, what, you know, everything else.
Exactly. So
But it was very cool to see those Easter eggs start falling, dropping in place.
Yeah, every place that they're starting to fill in.
Mm-hmm.
And it really gives you a better appreciation of Saul, I think. Because in Rogue One, I think even you said, it was like, I don't really like this guy. There's nothing to him.
There was no backstory. We got zero backstory on him.
Yeah.
It was just basically a, come with me. You know, you're like, what? Yeah. Like, I don't get it. What was his problem?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, after seeing him in Clone Wars young...
Right, very young.
And then now we're seeing him in Rebels as closer to his Rogue One age. Character. And we're actually seeing his thought process on stuff, how a lot of the stuff that he's been this conspiracy theory guy on has coming true.
Right.
Now we can, and we get the fact that he's abusing his prisoners.
Mm-hmm.
So now we see why that took place in Rogue One.
Yeah,
those I like the way it's starting to connect the dots.
Yeah, doing a nice job giving us little Easter eggs or carrots or whatever you mm-hmm. want to call it, carrot sticks. I did like how real quick that Chopper gets a new paint job.
Right, because all the bots in these episodes are yellow.
For some reason,
including the one that was on Yavin 4.
Yeah, which I didn't think about the one on Yavin 4. He was green and yellow though, but.
But it's still yellow.
Still yellow. But yeah, it's kind of a nice new paint job, I guess, for Chop. Mm-hmm. Even though Chopper doesn't like it.
Right. Yeah. And she's like, well, actually, I like this one better than the orange.
Yeah. Although I prefer the orange, but, you know.
Yeah.
This is a little too much Steelers for me. But anyway.
At least it wasn't black and yellow.
Yeah. I'm not a Steelers
fan. White and yellow is okay.
But anyway. So, Ezra, well, as soon as they get on the base, Ezra starts, like, hearing, like, singing. He keeps calling it singing. He's like, you hear that? What is that?
And nobody else hears it. I mean, we hear it.
Right. Through the...
But none of the other characters hear it.
None of the other characters are picking up on it. Which, right away, I automatically went, okay, it's definitely a Force thing. Not sure what's causing it, but...
Right.
It's something only a Force user...
Right. And I knew it was Force related, but I couldn't tell if it was an animal.
Right.
Because it had that, like a bird type of chirp.
Chirp, almost. And then it was drawn out, kind of. Mm-hmm. Like, you know. So... Yeah, it was. I was kind of wondering the same thing, but let's see. so they finally find some stormtroopers in the oddest place possible, guarding a door in this civilian transport. So,
right.
Even Sabine and Ezra are like, well, maybe he was right. You know, maybe he was onto something.
Cargo Bay 17.
17. Yep.
I have that notes.
I see that. Very nice. Well mm-hmm. done.
Mm-hmm.
They find some prisoners. Of all the same. And what kind of prisoners? Power technician, reactor mechanics, anything to do with power, it seems like.
Mm-hmm.
I think one guy said he was even like on Coruscant, he was just a power, a power engineer on Coruscant.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And that they asked him to come, the Empire tried to get him to come, they said no, and they just took him.
Yep, kidnapped him anyway.
So that shows you the...
to work on something in the Genesis
system. Interesting.
That's the first time we hear Jeddah system.
Yes. So, is it possible that the Death Star has been near Jeddah the whole damn time? Like, somewhere in there in the Jeddah system? Maybe not Jeddah yet, but, you know, I just wonder if that's where it's really hiding.
They even said in the Jeddah system, they were talking about it, where they said they were going.
Yeah, oh, they were going to the Jeddah system. That's right.
There was nothing there.
Right.
There's no planets, no nothing there.
Hmm. So,
and then Saul says, "Perfect place to hide something."
Yeah. So they're putting all these. We know what it is because we already know the end game. But it's obvious what's happening here. And
yep.
It's interesting though that the Empire is going to such extremes to kidnap people though to get them to work on their project. Anybody that knows anything about power, or,
right? And here we think that aside from
her dad. Jin's dad.
Aside from him, mm-hmm. we thought everybody else was for the Empire. Like they joined forces,
right? Yeah,
but here a lot of them weren't.
Yeah,
they were just forced to come,
conscripted, you know, drafted mm-hmm. in, so to speak, forced to, slaved in.
And this is another. This is the part of the story of Ezra, where he starts to see the difference between the rebellion and Saul, because he says, "This is awesome. We found these prisoners. We can save them." And Saul's like, no, I didn't come here for prisoners.
I came here
for the weapon.
I'm not interested in this.
And Ezra's like, but we can save these people.
Yeah.
And Saul's like, they have prisoners all over the galaxy. I don't care.
Exactly. Saul's all about the end game.
And you can see, then all of a sudden you can see Ezra's like,
he's starting to put two and two together,
yeah,
maybe a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
That this is not the Jedi way. This is not how I do things. But, you know, and this is obviously where Saul, and maybe Mon Mothma has maybe a point about it. Maybe.
Right.
So
this is where this right now is where Ezra and Sabine tell Chopper take the prisoners to the transport. So they're going to go disable the hyperdrive.
Right.
And they're going to go to engineering.
Yep.
So as they're going, for some reason they just follow Saul, who's not going to engineering to save anybody. He's going to try to find something else. So they end up in Hold 6.
Hold 6, which is where they find death troopers. Not stormtroopers, death troopers.
Exactly. That, and those are the black ones with the green eyes.
Yes. Like we saw in Rogue One.
Mm-hmm.
That were with, what's his name?
Tarkin?
Not Tarkin, but...
Krennic?
Krennic.
Yep.
Yeah. So another, again, death troopers. This isn't the first time for Rebels, but they're looking more like death troopers like we saw in Rogue One. Because I heard some fans say last season that there were certain things, minor things missing. You could actually tell that the eyes were more green looking this time.
Yep, and what I thought was really cool about this scene was, and it was right there by the door too, like when you open it was like right in your face.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden that it filled with smoke. And it's like, what do you see? And all of a sudden, all you see is his lightsaber running back and forth. And they're just shooting at nothing.
Randomly, yeah.
I mean, that was pretty cool to me. I thought that was one of the more neatest scenes that we got this episode.
Yeah, it was kind of cool to see a Jedi use Jedi speed and you see his lightsaber and using that, you know, that whole fog technique. And
then he went back to using the, not really a puppeteer, but he used the one as a puppet.
Yeah, he kind of stands him up in front of him.
And he's like, what are you doing? Blah, 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 or whatever his number was. And then all of a sudden you see the hand come up underneath and shoot the... Because it was Saul.
It was Saul doing it.
It was Saul.
So Saul's using a dead death trooper.
Which was pretty... I thought it was pretty good. And then he missed the trooper and hits the box.
Right, which sets it off.
And as soon as the box is hit...
It disintegrates.
All the death troopers said... He hit the box.
Yep.
It's unstable. Everybody get out.
Yep.
So then they all leave.
Mm-hmm. And the box disappears. Disintegrates. And what is there is a... I'd say probably about as long as... I don't know. I'm trying to think. Maybe a Cadillac is a...
Oh, I would say it's maybe bigger. I would say it's bigger than that. I would say it's at least 20 or 30 feet long.
Okay, so there's this giant green kyber crystal.
Right, because Ezra's like... It can't be.
And that's what's the singing.
And that's what's been singing to him because. And then he says, that makes sense. It's the same singing that I heard when I found my kyber crystal. It called out to me.
To his green lightsaber. Yeah. So you know he definitely understands the comparison. He understands that the connection that these things have to the Force, the energy of the Force, and energy in general. Because anything, even he explains, any energy that hits it is amplified. Or Sabine does actually.
Right. And she said, "So everybody, put away your blasters."
Yeah.
You know, and then you know it's funny, Brian. Have we seen anything like this yet? Is this the first time we've seen it?
No, they actually, because Kanan even references it in this.
It's the second time.
It's the second time. And that was, I think it was back all the way back in season one. They take out a small transport, and inside the transport was you don't even see the kyber crystal. But when they hit the transport blows up, and it's a green shockwave that comes out.
Right, right. But when we thought, I don't know if you thought at the time, I thought was that it was just a bunch of.
Smaller
kyber crystals, because even in Rogue One,
yeah, they're small.
They're transporting the kyber crystals
out. And
they're
clear too. That's the other thing.
Yeah, and you're like, oh, okay. Well, they're just transporting a bunch of the small ones out. Because and we're like, how is that? I was like, how in the world is that thing going to power the Death Star? There's no way you can get that many of those little small things to power the damn Death Star to blow up a planet.
Right.
But now we see how big this one is, and you're like, holy shit.
Yeah, that it would get a whole bank of those together. It's pretty easy.
Yeah.
Hook it up to a reactor, and voila, Death Star. Yep. You're right, Brian. This is definitely the second time in Rebels, although this is the first time we actually see it. And just to throw a little bit of Star Wars geekdom, there is a unfinished Clone Wars where they didn't finish the animation. But they put it on the website, and in that they found a similar kyber crystal of size and shape, and it was the same kind of outcome. We're seeing, again, you know, in a way, Filoni throwing more Clone Wars stuff that he never really got to finish put into Rebels. So.
Right, and then we're back to the Ezra's version of what a rebellion is and Saul's version of what a rebellion is.
And they get into the fight. It kind of comes to a head.
Because Ezra wants to destroy it.
Right.
And Saul's like, no, I want to see where we're going.
Yep.
Because he wants to follow Cookie Crumb still.
Exactly. And it's like, no, we need to save, what about the people? What about the prisoners? And they just, you know, it's a conflict of two different ways of looking at things and how you fight a war and what's the right way to fight a war. You know, that's really the overall theme of this whole episode. Really.
But it's funny because as soon as they come out of hyperspeed and he sees where they're at.
Yeah. Because he finally talks him into going to wherever, you know.
He finally sees where they're at and he says, he contacts two tubes to come get him.
Right.
And now that he sees where they're at, now he's ready to destroy it.
Yeah, now he's going to blow everything up.
Yes. And he fired at it for some reason.
Mm-hmm. And just to make it unstable.
And like Aaron was saying, I thought that's where he was going to get his injury that caused him to have to breathe like Vader.
Right.
But it didn't happen.
Right.
And then he's just like, you have your choice. You want to come with me and fight, or do you want to try to save your people? Or you want to try to save the prisoners? And Ezra's like, you fight your war, we'll fight ours.
Yeah. There's a definite...
And he's like, okay, bye, kid. Break.
Yeah, he just leaves him.
I was like, how the hell are they getting off this plane, off this ship?
Yeah.
And then we hear, you're...
Yeah, so in this, this whole episode, there's a death trooper who has a female voice, or a female tone voice, and they just refer to this special death trooper as Commander.
Commander.
That's all they say. But it's a female voice. It's a female in a death trooper outfit. My theory is this could be a very young Captain Phasma from Force Awakens. So, and it would make sense. It might make sense because we don't really know how old Phasma is yet. Because even though we know the actor who plays her,
but
she's not in. She never takes her helmet off.
I did just buy the Phasma book.
Yes,
that's going to go take place between the two movies and give a backstory on Phasma. So I will let you know if it has anything in there.
Uh-huh.
Because I heard what's his name, John Campia, talking about it on his Star Wars live show
about the book,
and I was like, oh my god, I didn't know that was out there.
Did he get an early preview of it or something?
Probably, because he said he's read it three times already.
Yeah, okay.
So, but I'm gonna sit down and read that.
Okay.
Got it on Amazon. I don't know if anybody wants to know that, but no, just type in Phasma on Amazon, and you can get the book I don't know how much it was, and then don't tell anybody. But if you tell them that the book cover's ripped, they'll give you $8 off.
Ooh.
And give you a credit on your account, so the next time you order something, you get $8 back.
See, so if you had listened to this whole podcast, you just got a hell of a tip.
Yeah.
So, I think this may indeed be a very young Phasma, because Filoni says that there is another villain lurking out there. He hinted at it in one of his interviews he did recently, that the Rebels might run into this other villain. So I could easily see them, and they go out of their way, because when the ship blows up, when the Star Destroyer blows up and the transport ship blows up, right before that, you see two little small Imperial transports.
But you don't.
Leave. Yeah, you do.
Okay, so I after you told me that, I went back and watched.
Uh-huh.
Those two transports are actually coming from the Star Destroyer
heading towards the transport.
There. But when we see everything blow up, we never see those transports leave.
You don't see them fly.
And
away.
Everything... on the other side of the Star Destroyer. That's why Sabine put her vessel on the other side.
Yeah.
Everything else got blown up. However,
to your
point, if one of those ships happens to have the same issue that Sabine's does, it's drifting in space.
Okay.
Which could be how she ends up with Snoke.
Could be.
Okay.
Yeah.
That could be how she ends up with Snoke because
Snoke finds her,
or somebody finds her because she's just floating
out in space randomly in the drift, the vastness of nothingness.
That's the only thing I could think of, because I watched and I didn't see any kind of ships going away, because I was like, oh, that's cool, but I saw them go to the freighter,
right?
But But I didn't see him leave.
See, I think that's classic Filoni. He just leaves the possibility open. And the fact that they put that scene in there just tells me that he wants to save... There's somebody on that ship he wants to save, Imperial-wise. So, otherwise, why do it, right? And why create this female commander for this one episode and kind of put so much emphasis on her? Because all the other stormtroopers are like, no, wait, we have to wait for the commander. Wait for, you know, they make...
She said we're holding this for her.
For her. So... She's a person of importance.
And it's the first time we've heard it.
Yeah.
Like, the first time we've heard of her.
Her.
Other than one of that other girl that was with Thawne.
Yeah, that's Governor Price. But
yeah.
In a stormtrooper outfit, nonetheless, much less a death trooper outfit.
So which means she's an elite.
Elite. Mm-hmm. Right, exactly. So it kind of adds up for me that I think this is Phasma.
Could be.
Yep.
Now, one thing I did want to talk about, we kind of jumped over it a little bit.
Okay.
But I put it in the notes here. Okay. Is it just me, or is Chopper becoming easier and easier to understand?
I think so. I think it's either that, or maybe it's just because we've gotten used to his
personality,
like, and how he acts.
Because, like, yeah. there was a thing, and there was one spot. I didn't catch it in a lot of the other ones. You know, he's
right.
But there's a spot. When he's helping the prisoners into the thing, and the one goes, "Well, you're a nice little droid, aren't you?" And he goes, "Well, how about that? Swear to God, listen to it." And he says, it's like almost like I'm like, no fucking way. Like, I don't speak droid.
But you might be.
But you know what I mean?
You might be understanding.
But it's really funny because it's like. He's becoming so much easier to
understand.
I don't know if they're doing it on purpose.
It could also be how they're accenting his voice maybe slightly. Like, they're putting more emphasis on more of the... When we first met him, it was more like Charlie Brown teacher. Womp, 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 womp. Now he's got more...
Womp, womp, womp.
Womp, 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 womp. Like on last episode, it was like you can almost hear him say, "Get a room," you know. He's like,
But listen to that spot when he's saying that.
I have to go back and listen.
I mean, it's you're like, ooh, I can actually understand that. I wanted to make sure I brought that up.
No, sure, absolutely. No, that's a good point. As we close out here, you put this in the notes, and I think it's a good point. Sabine asked the question: can a kyber crystal of that size be weaponized? To Kanan. You know, once they're all back together. Because the ghost does show up to save Sabine and Ezra, by the way. But you know, Kanan says, "I don't know, but this is the second one we've destroyed," which we talked about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
"So it must be something important." And Ezra says, "Well, what if Saul's right and the Empire's ready to fight a war that the Rebel Alliance doesn't even believe has started yet?" And it's a really good point that Ezra makes there.
Right.
And we've heard that same line, though, in the trailer.
Right.
But yeah, it does bring up the point, though, is are they so caught up with trying to wait for the absolute right, perfect moment politically in fighting amongst themselves that the other
side has amassed such a force that they're not going to be able to fight it.
And not only is it already an overwhelming force conventionally, you add a weapon of mass destruction or weapons of mass destruction to his arsenal, I mean, it makes it even that much harder, right?
Right.
If not, near impossible.
Right. The other thing I want to take away from that scene right before that is, you know, they're thanking Hera and them for saving them, and she's like, "Oh, we'll get you back to your planet, you know, as soon as we can."
Yeah.
And we don't want to go home.
Yeah, they want to join.
We've all discussed it, and if the Empire felt we were that important, then we would do them that much more harm by coming to work for you and the Rebel Alliance.
That's a really good point. I forgot about that whole scene. Yeah, that shows. You know, kind of how people are thinking now. You know,
yeah, and it's coming around. It's the whole like they're not trying to get people.
Yeah,
it's like basically almost word of mouth. Mm-hmm. You are for a good cause. We're going to come fight with you.
We're going to fight for you, and you know the Empire has become something that is intolerable now.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, so we're gonna do more good with you than give them. And really, if you think about it, if they were to go home, the Empire would probably just grab them again anyway, right?
So, well, you better kill them.
Yeah. That too. All right. Real quick, Brian, your final thought and grade for In the Name of the Rebellion Part 1 and 2.
I'm going to say, like what we discussed before on those first two episodes, you know, we were really let down.
Yeah.
These, I'm not let down at all.
No.
I'm going to say this is this is right on the borderline of AA plus for me. Mm-hmm. Like this episode was really good. I think it was, and I think it had a lot to do with the fact all the Easter eggs got dropped in on us, and
yes,
how we got to see some of this stuff come together. We know what it's the Death Star, mm-hmm. and we're watching Saul put these pieces together.
Yep.
We're watching, you know, we're like, ooh, this is, you know, this is kind of cool. For me, it was the scene with the big giant kyber crystal.
Yes,
because I'd always thought, I was like, how are they going to get the small ones?
Mm-hmm. Starting to make sense.
Yeah, it's starting to make sense. Like, well, yeah, if you had a kyber crystal that big, I didn't know they got that big. If you had one that big,
right?
Then of course
you can make a giant lightsaber,
exactly,
or something else.
Essentially, yes.
Yeah, I agree 1,000% with you. I think it's absolutely an A+. I think this is the episode where they start putting down some themes, maybe for the rest of the season, that we're going to see play out. We're going to see Ezra continue to struggle with not only are we fighting, but how do we choose to fight, and are the rebels too late, and how are we going to help Lothal, and all these things are going to play out through Ezra's head, and the rest of the rebels, and how that's going to affect them going forward in their final season, and how's it all going to end? There's so much to tie up still. I mean, I'm not really seeing anything tied up nice and tight yet.
Okay, so I'm going to throw a theory right here for you.
All right.
Okay, here's how I see it playing out. We know where Saul ends up.
Okay.
Because he's actually live action, we see him.
Okay.
We know where Hera ends. Hera and Chopper.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're in Rogue One too.
Right.
I think Ezra.
Mm-hmm.
Leaves to go help with Saul.
Okay.
Okay. And I think he leaves after Zeb and Kanan die.
Okay.
So I think that's how this season's gonna play out for us. And I think that's how we're gonna see them go their separate ways. I'm not sure about Sabine yet.
Mm-hmm.
If she's gonna go back to
Mandalore,
or if it ends up being Sabine, Kanan, and Zeb that die.
That's very possible.
Really causing pain for Ezra, because it's not only is his father figure gone,
yeah.
His also his
love interest
is gone as well.
Right.
And it kind of just sends him into that loner path.
Yeah, all away from the Force, away mm-hmm. from everybody.
Yep.
Yeah, I definitely think Kanan, and I said this in the season preview, I think Kanan's a goner. I think that's... I just don't see a scenario where he survives. Sabine could easily be sent back to Mandalore. You could easily keep her alive that way, because we really don't know what's going on in Mandalore through the whole classic trilogy. Ezra, somehow I got a feeling that this DJ character, we're going to see in episode 8 coming up, is Ezra Bridger. Before it seemed like more of a wild rumor, but there's been a new picture. They've shown a scar on his cheek. They're either really playing with us with the scar to make us, you know, send us off on a tangent, but they've gone out of their way to try to hide this scar from us in these pictures that we still frames. We don't see this DJ character in any of the trailers, and we've only seen still pictures of him. So, and just the way I could actually see Ezra following kind of Kanan's path if things don't go well for him. Like if Kanan dies, if Sabine dies, something else happens, I can see him deciding to walk away from the Jedi Order and become kind of the cowboy Jedi that Kanan was. I would have told you earlier, before the whole picture thing, with the scar, I would have said maybe 25% is Ezra. Now I'm thinking it's more like 60% that I think this DJ character is Ezra. So, and he's going to be kind of like the scoundrel, really, I think, by that point in time. We'll see. So... there's plenty to talk about, with plenty of things yet to come. So lots and lots of things to come. So I just want to thank Aaron, who is still asleep. But I want to thank him for joining us. And I'm sure he was more than happy to join us, at least for the first episode or part of it. And Brian, I want to thank you for joining us.
Hey, thanks for having me, man.
And this is... real quick, where can you find 4 Midwest Guys? You can go to... I always forget this part. If you go to the website, you type in the number 4 and type in MidwestGuys.com all together. So that's the number 4, MidwestGuys.com. Again, number 4, MidwestGuys.com. There, everything is listed for you. Links to our iTunes, to our Twitter, to our Facebook, to our Podbean. You can follow, like, subscribe there. Or you can actually, all of our podcasts are listed there chronologically, or you can go categorized with links at the top.
If you just want to see all the Star Wars Rebels together on one page, you click the Star Wars Rebels link. If you like our any of our Game of Thrones podcasts, which there's two of, House of Zanardelli or The Night's Watch, you can click each one of those and get individual of those. I know John's been busy with his movie Masochist. I think he's got 3 episodes up now of that. There's lots of different things out there. Lots of different special series that we do. Even I know we reviewed a lot of the Netflix shows so far. Mm-hmm. We did a rapid reaction just recently on Star Trek, mm-hmm. and hopefully we'll get one out on Orville soon. So lots of different stuff out there, and they're not, you know, we're gonna try to mix it up. They're not all gonna be long like these are. We're gonna do some short ones too. Definitely check us out. Go to the 4. Now, again, that's the number 4, MidwestGuys.com.
And tell your friends and like us on Facebook. We'd like to get our numbers up.
Yep. And not only that, but feedback. Feedback.
Subscribe to users.
Subscribe, like, subscribe, you know. And give us some comments. If you like us, if you didn't like us, especially if you didn't like us even, I want to know why. I mean, I would love some really good feedback. So.
Oh, yeah. Or ideas, what you think we should cover.
Yeah, and how to cover it. So, all right. So, this has been Star Wars Rebels HQ, and I'm B. Willie saying, may the Force be with you always.